So hello everybody, welcome to today's Samvad talk. This is on AI-based narrative arc generation for an engaging learning experience. The talk is going to be delivered by Chaitali Diwan and Prakar Mishra from IIIT Bangalore. This session is being chaired by Professor Srina Srinivasa, who is a professor at IIIT Bangalore. Srinath heads the Web Science Lab and is the current Dean R&D at IIIT Bangalore. He holds a PhD from the Berlin Brandenburg Graduate School for Distributed Information Systems in Germany, and an MS by research from IIT Madras and BE from NIE Mysore. He works in the area of web science on models that impact the web on humanity. He is part of several conference organization leadership teams in the country as well as outside. And he has also won several grants, prestigious national as well as international grants for his research activities. So without much ado, I would like to invite Professor Srina Srinivasa to take over the stage. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Jaya. So, this project is part of the work that we are doing with Guru Labs. Guru, as you may know, is a non-profit society or organization from the Silicon Valley, spin-off from Google. Who is pioneering a concept called learning maps. The idea here is to represent an online learning space in the form of 2D maps. Currently, the state of the art represents online learning in the form of learning pathways, which are basically playlists of learning resources. The change or the new novelty from what Guru Labs is doing, or Guru is trying to come up with, is to represent a learning space in the form of a map, with the idea that humans are very adept at navigating maps, from a long time. So to represent a lot of information in the form of a map, and representing goals and representing strategies and so on, which can be done in the form of a map. So this work has a number of research scholars working on this. Here we'll be presenting two of them. So we are not presenting the map generation part itself, which is managed or which is addressed by Sham and Prasida, who are creating some kind of background measurement space as well as a semantic space, which is what we call the competency map and the learning map respectively. So we won't be talking about that, but instead we'll be talking primarily about learning pathways itself. So once we think of a map, a 2D map representation, where learning goals as well as sequences of learning resources can be represented in the form of learning pathways, is in turn supported by what is called as a learning navigator. Chaitali here is working on designing the learning navigator, where given a learning goal, the navigator can in some sense handhold the learner, pretty much akin to what a Google navigator does. When you have a destination goal, the navigator determines where you are currently and then curates a route towards you, which is sometimes based on your personal preferences as well. So which is pretty much what we are doing in a learning space. So Chaitali's work will be looking at how we can generate a learning route, which is what is called the narrative arc. So the narrative arc is basically a sequencing of learning experiences so that it forms a coherent narrative, coherent learning narrative. Okay. And Prakar is working on a similar support project for this, where given a learning pathway, can we summarize the learning pathway in the form of a movie trailer? Right. Especially in the online settings, videos and trailers are kind of seen as somewhat akin to movie trailers, right? They're seen to be very effective in learners being able to take on a particular learning pathway. So without further ado, we'll start with Chaitali's talk, presenting her narrative arc problem, and then we'll move on to Prakhar's talk, where he'll be presenting his trailer generation. On to you, Chaitali.
Good afternoon, everybody. Today I'm going to talk on my work, AI-based narrative arc for engaging learning experience. As ma'am has already told, I'm part of WSL lab and my supervisor is Srinath Srinivasa. Kindly excuse me for my voice. I've been having cough and cold for a couple of days, so it's a bit flat. So learners and educators have been increasingly relying on internet for education, more so during this pandemic. But we have seen that educators and learners have not been able to leverage the technology in education, especially in the disadvantaged economies and social cultural backgrounds. So we have seen that most of the classes which were conducted online were just on Zoom call, and it was more of taking a classroom online. But the technology what we have seen in education, none of them were being utilized as much as we could during this pandemic time. So even though there are platforms such as MOOCs which are offering education anytime, anywhere to learners of any age and culture, this has not been seen on the ground here when we were seeing the online education for the past one and a half years. So this is mainly because building the technology enhanced learning system takes tremendous amount of effort in terms of time, cost, and expertise. So building such a system is not so easy, and adopting the one immediately is also a difficult task. So not only that, but apart from building the cost of learning system, there is another problem which is faced by the online learning systems, large online learning systems and MOOCs, is the motivation and engagement of the learner. So intelligent tutoring systems are able to provide such a personalized learning where they increase engagement, but the ITS, they cannot be implemented at a scale of MOOCs. Also, they are even more expensive to build in terms of cost and as well as in terms of speed. We cannot curate ITS resource very easily, because most of these are built for a particular platform. Say I want to learn Python, then the ITS whole system is built for one particular subject. And then if I want to take it for another subject, you have to altogether make a new one. So there they involve subject matter experts. They'll need people to do the coding to bring this system up. So these are the difficulties which are present in the current usage of the current learning platforms. Another point that we see is educational systems are mostly proprietary. They are built by a single platform. So the same platform person, they curate the learning resources. So all of them would be in a particular standard. They'll have particular metadata. So also they are not domain neutral. You build for one system, you will not be able to easily take it to another domain or subject. So what we are looking at in this work is there are so many innumerable open online learning resources which can be used. So can we leverage these open resources and build a system which anybody can easily use and help to create the engaging narrative? So in these kind of systems, mostly the engagement, for creating engagement also, the systems are built manually. Like if you want to give a test after certain resources, so then these are also built, mostly built manually or by a single platform. So in this work of narrative arc, we propose a concept which aims to address these two issues. First, of building a domain neutral or domain agnostic learning environments. And second, of increasing the learning engagement in these learning environments. So the idea here is to formulate learning as a narrative between the learner and the learning environment through a conversational pedagogic agent. So there is a pedagogic agent which will be conversing with the learner and with the learning environment. And through this, we are building the narrative. So Narrative Arc is an AI-based framework, and it proposes to provide an engaging experience for any given corpus of learning resources. So the automation here helps to create an easy to build and engaging experience at scale and for any domain, unlike the learning environment such as ITS and MOOCs. So since we are using AI-based solutions here, we are able to build this on any platform, and it is relatively easier to build it and take it to other subjects and domains. So to create such a system, what are the things that are required? Is the first one is we say is to create a two-dimensional competency map that provides overview of the corpus and helps to explore the learning space. So if we are given a corpus of learning resources which are open, the first thing we do is we organize it in such a way that on the x-axis there are topics and on the y-axis there are levels. So once this organization is done, then we go ahead and build the learning pathways using this competency maps. So the all of these is automatic. So we automatically generate this two-dimensional space and we embed all the learning resources we have onto this space. Then we go and use the automatic generation method to create the learning pathways, which are semantically coherent and they are progressive. By progressive, we mean that when you move from one learning resource to the next, you are learning something new and you're progressing on the learning space. And finally, we also present the automatic generation of the narrative arc itself to create an engaging learning experience. So it may so happen that you have learning pathways, which are just coherent sequence of learning resources, but to generate the kind of interest and engagement, we create the narrative arcs automatically. So we generate some certain narrative fragments which are added to these learning pathways, and together they form a narrative. So this is the block diagram of the proposed approach. We are given a corpora of learning resources, and from this a competency map is generated. These same learning resources, we generate metadata because most of these are open online resources. They are not in a standard format. So for us to be able to generate the pathway, we need a certain aspect. So we generate the metadata ourselves, and then we use that to create the pathways. Once the pathways are generated, we create the narrative arc elements into it, like adding some kind of tests and adding some kind of overviews to the learning pathway to make it interesting. And then this is interacting with the learner through a narrative arc learning portal. So this is fed into the portal. Very short review of what is competency map. As I told, on the x-axis we have topics organized, and on the y-axis we have levels organized. So we use topic modeling, word embedding, and document embeddings to create this competency map and also to place the resources on them. I'm not going into detail of this, but this is general idea how we embed the resources onto the two-dimensional space. Then learning pathways are actually the the sequences of these learning resources to reach a particular destination, which is to reach a particular goal we have in learning, as Professor mentioned. So learning pathways are built such that the two main conditions are met. One is of semantic coherence and one is of progression. So when you move from one learning resource to another, there should be the topic subtopic overlap, and it should not be suddenly out of place. Because we are dealing with the open learning resources, it may so happen that a particular learning resources is explained in one way, and the next one might be completely different. We don't want to do that. We want to keep the topical dissonance to the minimum. Say you have learning resources which uses graph theory to explain you something, and then the next resource, if it uses set theory to explain the next concept on it, it might not be very coherent. So what we should do is, if we could use the same subtopic to tell the next resource also, that means there is a coherence in the pathway. And similarly, progression, it should not happen that we are picking up the resource which is similar to the previous resource with different with the topics which are overlapping, but it should also add something to the previously generated topic. So these are the two things we check while creating the learning pathways. So for generation of learning pathways, there are two components. One is the greedy generator. So it just goes ahead and picks the next best learning resource based on the semantic coherence and progression from a neighborhood. And then we have another component called validator. So when the learning pathway reaches certain window size, this validator validates if the pathway is coherent as a whole. It may so happen that the neighboring learning resources are coherent with each other, but when you look at a larger window, it may not be coherent, or it may be disoriented. So validator goes and says that, okay, even in this kind of window, there is a coherence and there is progression. So if the validator doesn't find it to be a coherent pathway, a greedy generator goes back and it tries to pick another learning resource so that the whole itself is coherent as well. So there is a feedback loop between these two components. This is a diagram of the learning pathway generation model. Given an initial learning resource, we get the candidate learning resources from the neighborhood. So we get this neighborhood using the competency map, which I showed you, the X and Y axis. And once we get this resources which are in neighborhood, we have to pick the best resource, which will be the next resource in the pathway. So for that, what we do is we randomly take the resource from this set. We generate the pathway model. We generate the pathway metrics. Like I told you, since they are open learning resources, we need some kind of metadata. So we generate that here. And then we have trained a classifier model, which takes which is trained on the neighboring resources in the learning pathways, which are already present in Guru. So we train the model in that way. So it tells us if the pair of the learning resources is coherent or not. If it is coherent, then we go ahead and we pick the next resources until the validator window is reached. Otherwise, we would just go ahead, pick the next resource, and till we find a resource which we can say is the best next resource for the learning pathway. Then the validator checks it. The validator is also based on human curated pathways. So we take the human curated pathways and we train an neural net model, and we validate if the given resource is valid or not. And once it is valid, and if our goal is reached, we don't want more resources, then we stop. If it is not, then we go ahead and increase the learning pathway to create a pathway of the desired length. This is a sample learning pathway, which is generated by our model. So here I've just shown us short summaries of the learning resources that are present. I am not showing how we have tested it or evaluated it. I'll just tell in brief what we do for evaluation is, we start with the human curated pathways. We take the same starting resource as a human curated pathway and generate a pathway using our model. And then we see if the learning resources which are generated by our model and the ones by the human curated, is there an overlap topically? It may not pick up the same resources, but how much of overlap is there topically is what we will check using Jaccard similarity and that's how we have validated the learning pathway model. Now, coming to the narrative arc. So here we define something called as narrative fragments. So these are the short fragments we add between the learning pathways to make it make the learning engaging and interactive. As you can see in this figure, this is a learning pathway, which an example learning pathway. And what we do is when we have a learning pathway, we divide it into meaningful segments. So here you can see that this pathway is divided into three segments. One is unit fractions, one is compare fractions, and another one is operation on fractions. So this kind of gives us a point where we can introduce the narrative fragments. So we call each of these as a region, and in the beginning or end of these regions, we add these narrative fragments. So here we can see that the some of the narrative fragments we add is the overview for the particular region, then reflection quizzes at the end of the segment, then the overview of the next region. Then we also have reflection through concept construction, where the learner can go ahead and enter the concept, and the framework can give you a feedback about the understanding of the concept. And there is on-demand fragment like question answering. If while learning this learning pathway, user has some question which may be related to it but not present in the resources, user can ask the question here, and the narrative arc element can help to answer the questions. If more resources are required for that particular question, the framework will go ahead and bring that resource up for the user. So that way we are saying that we are not just sticking to the path. If there is a need, the learning pathway can be modified accordingly. This not only during question answering, but also during reflection quiz. And so if for a particular region, we have given about 4 quizzes and we get a score of less than 50%, the threshold can be set as we need, but currently we have set it as 50%, then we can still ask the user, if they want to learn more about the already unit fractions, or they want to know about the prerequisites. So it's like we are conversing with the learner to understand their needs. So, and there is also a narrative fragment in which we are generating the trailer for the entire learning pathway. Prakhar is going to talk about this in the next part of our talk. So the narrative fragments, like I told you, there's trailer. There is multiple choice questions or reflection quizzes. There's overview of segments, reflection through concept constructions, and the on-the-fly question answering. So very briefly, how do we actually generate these segments? So the segments represent a meaningful regions, which consequently define the checkpoints of learning. So these checkpoints are used to insert the narrative fragments. To find the boundary of region, we encode each learning resource using the universal central encoding. Then we take cosine similarity between the consecutive resources in pathway. Whenever the cosine similarity dips below a certain threshold, we break the region there. So the threshold for this is taken from our corpus itself. So we take all the learning pair resources which are consecutive in the learning pathway in our corpus, and we take cosine similarity between both of them and see where it peaks, and we consider that to be a threshold for breaking point. So here we have done manual inspection, and we have found out that the human segmentation was almost similar to what our model has done, about 85% of accuracy. Then I'll directly jump into the narrative fragment generation. So one of the narrative fragment generation is multiple choice question generation. So this is the block diagram of the multiple choice question generation. So given a learning resource, we extract the keywords from the learning resource. We call a definition generator, which is a GPT-2 based model. This generates definitions. The thing with this generative type of models is that they are probabilistic in nature, and it may so happen that the generator generates different definitions every time. They might be semantically same, but they are not exactly the same because it is based on heuristics. So we have a validator and a selector to select the definition among this, which we want to generate the questions. So first of all, what the validator does is it makes sure that the definition is closer to the learning resource that we are considering. Once that is approved, we say that the definition is accepted. And among the accepted definitions, we have a selector which will select the best definition among the generated definitions. And for that definition, we create the questions depending on using a rule-based model. And similarly, options are created directly from the keyword. So we generate two types of options, a semantic and syntactically closer. And the correct answer is the fourth option. And third option is a random choice between the syntactic and semantic option. So there have been the question generation models which people have been researching. However, what we found is that most of these models are based on picking particular sentence from the learning resources, and that particular sentence they are creating as a question. So while this may work whenever there is a straightforward statements in the learning resource from which question can be generated, our model also works when there may not be straightforward definition saying this particular concept means this or something. So even if we just get a keyword about what the learning resource is, we will be able to generate the questions for it because we have a definition generator ourselves. Another advantage of our question generation model is that we will not only be able to generate one question or two straightforward question by extracting the sentences, but if there are more meaningful keywords, we'll be able to generate more questions. And this will be helpful so that there can be a rotation of questions in the learning pathway. You don't need to show the same questions every time. So if suppose a student has not done well in an exam and he goes back and understands the resources, then probably you will not, if you give him the same question, then maybe he has understood, okay, this has to be answered, and he will answer it that way. But here, if you have rotated the question, then probably you will try to understand the student has understood the concept better or not. So that way we can use rotation of questions for the learning resources as well. So this is the unique proposition that we have proposed in our model. And also other kind of question generations have not looked at neural networks for generation. Most of them are looking at keyword generation. So there, here is where we are proposing that we are using the probabilistic model to be able to generate questions. So as I told that we have used we have fine-tuned a pre-trained model. So for fine-tuning, we use a database where we have a pair of input-output pairs such as keywords and the definition for it. We have used the large size model of 774 million parameters. We have done a bit of experiments on the type of temperatures we need to use for inferencing and the kind of decoding model we need to use. I have not included that into this. Neither have I included the results. Let me just complete this thing. So in validator, as I told, you will filter out the genuine definitions. This is done by vectorizing the generated definition and the obtained summary. I am saying obtained summary because the most of the learning resources that we have are in the form of links, because Google is a aggregator platform, but it does not store the learning resource as such. It stores the link, and the original resources are at the cloud or the site from where we are cited. So we only have the URLs. We go to those URLs, we crawl those pages, and we get the transcripts, and then we automatically generate the summaries from that. So that's why I've written the obtained summary of learning resources. So we vectorize both of them, and we take cosine similarity. And we accept the definitions only which are above the threshold of cosine similarity. So we obtain this threshold of cosine similarity using two data sets of SNLI and SICK data set. In this data sets, there are pairs of learning resources and they are labeled by humans, where the pair of learning resources are labeled as accepted, as neutral, contradiction, and entailment. So we take the threshold above the contradiction. So we accept the neutral and the entailment kind of sentences. So that's how we have taken the threshold of cosine similarity. Then among the definitions, we select the definition with the highest cosine similarity. Then we have simple rule-based approach to convert definition to questions like what do you replace? Like you replace the keyword with the what, then correct tenses are formed or not. And if the sentences have start information like in mathematics, and then the definition comes. So we check for these kind of things. If there are acronyms and there is an expansion of acronyms in the start of the definition, then we need to remove those. So we have seen the definitions that are getting generated, and we have come up with this rule-based model to generate the questions. Then the options are generated such that first is a semantic option. So here we take the words which are closest to the given keyword, and we take the Euclidean distance between them. So then we choose the one which is most semantically closer to the resource. Then in the second option, we take all the resources, all the keywords which are in neighborhood of the particular keyword, and we use Levinson distance to see if the word is similar syntactically to the given keyword. And the third one is we have the neighborhood with us. Anything random from that, we pick either semantic or syntactic, but from that neighborhood. And the fourth option is actually the correct option. So we randomly shuffle this when we are generating our MCQ. So this is one of the examples of the MCQ. This is the auto-generated summary that we have obtained. And this is the question which is formed for this one. So the keyword that was extracted was greenhouse effect. And this is a question for that. And the two options are semantically closer and one is a syntactic option. So the way we have tested this is we have generated the MCQs, and we have given these to human evaluators. Different questions like this were randomly picked from the generated definitions and given to the user. The user would ask questions like, is the question grammatically correct? Is it is it semantically correct? Are the options close enough to the correct option, but we are still having a clarity of picking up the right option? And is the question itself related to the learning resource? So we measured the human evaluation using these questions, and we have obtained encouraging results in this. Then similarly, for generating an overview for a learning pathway, initially we started off with generating overview like a summary. So we tried different models where we could give the keywords in the learning resources in a region, and we can automatically generate summary for it and show it as an overview. But we felt that that is not creating interest, or it's just a large paragraph which a user may not be interested in seeing. So we wanted to make the overview interesting. So what we did is we are using a template-based model. For that, what we are doing is first we are extracting the keywords from the learning resources, and then we use these keywords and the neighborhood to find out the parent keyword, that is what is the whole region about. So there could be learning resources like different kind of seaweeds. So there is red coralline, there is algae, and there is blue coralline, all these different seaweeds. So we identify that, okay, all these are about these seaweeds and we say, okay, what is a seaweed? And then we say that in the learning resources, we are introducing you red seaweed, we are introducing you yellow seaweed, and these kind of things is built into different templates. So once we take the root word, say here it is a seaweed, then we go and get the definition from the GPT-2 model, the same definition model which I explained earlier. Given a keyword, it gives us a definition. So similar to the previous model, we have to validate the definition and then we select the right definition for the template. Also, we select the templates. Even though we have taken so much care that the root words should generate a definition which is good, it may so happen that our GPT-2 model is not able to generate a definition for it. So in that case, the template chosen would be such that it is just talking about the keyword, the parent keyword, and does not necessarily go and define the model. So, or if the key, suppose all the three learning resources are about the same topic, say chromosome, and but the resources are telling in different way. They are saying, okay, this is a image of chromosome. You have to identify what are the parts or what are the different structure in the chromosome. And the next one is actually an interactive resource about a chromosome. So it's all about the same topic. In that case, it's just like one root word is a chromosome, but the type of resources are different. So that way we have a different template there to identify the way to put this, like, okay, there is a commonality and the way of presenting the resources is different. So that way we have a couple of templates and this is automatically chosen depending on the circumstances and the definitions that are produced. So one in overview generation, like I told you, we first extract the summaries, we extract noun key phrases, and then we take the root word which describes the aboutness of a region. We call the definition model and we filter these definitions later and we put them into a template. I forgot to mention here, we first select a template and then we put them into templates. So this is one of the overviews. So here this region has three learning resources and it is about Mesopotamian civilization. And so we have, this is the root word we have obtained. And if you see the template here, so you take the root word, you get the definition of that root word. And then in the template, we have what we substitute the learning resources with the particular keyword. So here Mesopotamian region is the religion is the keyword for the first learning resource. Then the second learning resource is about legal systems. So next one, it says it's about Egyptian legal systems. And then it says, finally, you will learn about Sumerian government, because the third learning resource is about the Sumerian government. And this is just dummy, like, let's get started to know about this. So these are the different, this is one of the templates from many templates we have for overview generation. So for overview generation also, we did a human evaluation and we asked similar questions, whereas which some of the questions were, if the overview is related to the learning resources in question, and if the overview is semantically fine, semantically correct, if it is syntactically correct, etc. So here also we have obtained encouraging results from the human evaluation. The next, we were talking about the conversational agent. Here we want to bring these elements in the form of conversational agent. So right now it's a simple chat bot, and the narrative fragments are introduced through this conversational agent. So whatever happens, like we are showing this overview or anything, the chat bot says, okay, now we'll see an overview, and then the overview comes up. Or whenever the user finishes a learning pathway region, the conversational agent says, okay, come on, let's go and take a quiz. And once the quiz results are done, the conversational agent figures out if we have to encourage the learner or if they need to repeat something, some learning resource, or if they need to we talk with the learner to understand these, and depending on that, the path may be changed. So the conversational agent takes the actions accordingly. So the in conversational agent generation, that there are three important parts. First one is the intention identification. So from our end, when we are showing overview or we are showing the quiz, we don't need any of these components because it's from the learning system point of view. So we know where is the breakpoint where we need to introduce the narrative fragments. But the other way, when the user is asking the question to the conversational agent, then we need these components. The first one is we have to identify the intention of the user. So what does the user want? Is he wanting to understand something about a learning resource? If he's saying explain this or what is this particular term or such kind of things, we have to understand. Or it's just like saying, okay, thanks, I understood this well, and I want to know more about this resource. We have to just understand what is the intention. So it's not that we have covered everything, only few intentions which are relevant to learning resources, which we could identify. We have just trained a model on those intentions. Then there is a story or scenario. So once you have seen the intention, we need to know what to do about it. So in this story or scenario, the intention and actions are mapped to each other. So if this is an intention, you take this action. And then there is also a scenario such that, okay, now that you have shown answer to a question, you ask the user, do you want to learn more? So that also goes as one of the steps in the stories. So we have to go ahead and build these kind of scenarios. So it's not that it is different for every subject. Once we build, it can be ported anywhere, but once we'll have to go ahead and create this. So this is a very old screen. Server was down, so I could not take the recent snapshot. So this is the conversational agent. You go and ask the question and it gives the answer. This was an old model, excuse me for the same. Right now we have created the model where we have one line definition. And through this model, we are able to converse with the user. So if he has a question, he will go ahead and type here. So similarly, now you have given a definition, but the story is that if you want to learn more, we can ask this learner, you have understood this, do you want to know more? If he says yes, then we go and search for that resource, and when the user clicks, he comes back to the screen where he can learn about that particular resource. So this is how we have created the conversational agent. So currently we have not done any kind of evaluation for the conversational agent. We have just done for the fragments. So in future, we would like to try this narrative arc framework in a learning settings to understand even if the conversational agent is working and see the results. We want to apply the narrative fragment generation to different domain. Right now we have worked only with science and math domains from the guru, but we want to see if we are able to implement this in one of our subjects like network science for web, which is taken by professor. So are we able to generate this kind of overviews, MCQs for that? And the last one is if there are more scenarios we could add to the conversational agent. So this is the future work. So I would be stopping here. From now, Prakhar will be taking any questions still here, or should we take it at the end of the presentation?
I think there is one question from Professor Prasanna. What is the runtime for GPT and what platform did you use?
So we have run it on Colab, Google Colab, and the training didn't take a long time. It was about 2 to 3 hours for training the definition model, because there was already pre-training. So all we had.
Yeah, how long again you said? I couldn't.
It was just 2 to 3 hours on Colab, Google Colab.
Okay. How many training examples and so on?
We have around 80,000 examples, keyword and definition pairs, which we took from Wikipedia.
Yeah. So, okay. Because we have a powerful machine.
Okay. Yeah, surely we can explore that.
And right? You, you, yeah, you can, if If you tell us what would be ideal, we'll see if you can use it. It's much more powerful.
Oh, thank you so much, sir. We will connect.
You send me email.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
I guess we can get started with Prakhar.
Yes, sir. Sure. So, hello, everyone. I'll be talking about the second aspect of the project, which is trailer generation, which again is a component to narrative arc. I'm working under the supervision of Professor Srina Srinivasa and co-supervision of Professor G. Srinivas Raghavan. So talking about the definition of trailers to essentially what trailers are. So trailers are short previews of a piece of content that are designed to give overview of the underlying document fused with certain interesting elements in order to garner users' interest. So in this study, we essentially focus on automatically generating such trailers to get quick sense of narratives built using academic resources of various forms. So by various forms, as in it could be a podcast, it could be a video, it could be a textual resources. Each of them can be given and essentially we can convert at the back end to any normalized form and we can process over that. So with the help of this, the learner can glance and get idea to the course and be clear in terms of what to expect and what not to, and whether it's a good fit for him or not, even before he starts his journey. So again, what are we trying to do over here exactly is to kind of semi-automate this entire process, because manual generation of these trailers are costly and time consuming, as it requires people with skills over broad spectrum, such as video editing, then domain knowledge, and then definitely it requires significant time, effort, and budget. So as a part of this work, we try to semi-automate this entire pipeline that would hopefully reduce the human efforts and enable even non-video editors to produce decent trailers. Also, we propose something what we call as creators dashboard that tries to incorporate creators' preferences or any special instructions while creating new trailers from scratch with the editing functionality. So the right figure that you see is a very, very high level view of what we are trying to do. So the idea is like you give it certain set of resources along with the user input, and the video is what we generate. And we do have a back loop where we give a functionality of editing the produced trailer based on human preferences. So talking about the trailer structure and themes. So if we break down the trailer, the left figure is what you see. It can be hierarchically broken down in a tree-like structure. The first is what we have, the MP4 file, which is the trailer, which can be broken down into multiple topics or themes. Now, each of the themes can again be broken down into multiple slides that correspond and give content for that particular topic. Now, the elements, when we talk about frame or slide level thing, the things that we can put over there is the transition, how we transition from one element to other, and the content essentially of that slide, which is the leaf level node over here. So the right figure is what we come up with by manually analyzing 20 odd trailers from various websites like Coursera and Udemy. So this is the timeline and this is the most intersected theme elements that go along with all 20 trailers. You start off by branding the course. You start off by, then you go to introducing the instructor or the author who is going to take that course. You talk about the topic, you tell the course outline in terms to what to expect. You give certain social proof, validation, or motivation. And then finally ending up with call to action, essentially what you should be doing after you have done with watching this entire course. So the below piped elements that you see are essentially some of the elements that if you put in a trailer are ideally supposed to make your trailer more effective. So the first is essentially the introduction to you or the product, because again, your audience might not have any idea to who you are or what course, or what this course is about. Then adding visual elements is preferable because those are processed faster compared to the textual elements. Then the third is reinforcing connection, like course name, logo, all of these can be put across slides to reinforce the connection between what they are watching and what they are supposed to do at the end of the trailer is done. Then call to action is like all the energy and emotion that your video generates over, let's say, a 1 minute long end will be useless until it is not directed towards something, which could be as simple as enrolling to a course. And then social proof is again a motivation. And like some of the statements for that could be, let's say, 91% of the people who took this course were hired within a month. So this again kind of builds sense of trust. So as of now, you must have already guessed there are a lot of moving parts which are pretty complex in terms of how this entire experience is going to be, because this is again a multi-modality. If you see, there are multiple modalities involved. As such, text is there, you have voiceovers, you have sounds. So again, arranging all of these things in a certain way so that it creates more impact is really important. So we propose a template guided trailer generation flow, where a template is nothing but a set of constraints that we define with respect to elements, as in what elements could be there on a frame, their positioning, the style, maybe the background sound, the voiceover, all of that. So the video that I'll just show, it's 10 second long. So again, the template, for example, you can think of iMovie or Google Slides, essentially, where they give you, these are the places where you can fit in elements for every particular theme or template. So now if I play this, so as you can see, this is the first frame where it tells you, you have two places to insert any two elements, as in the middle one and the top one. And if you go forward again, you see new frames with the new positioning to where you can insert things. So this is the idea of template. Now on the right hand side, what you see is the theme that we follow to create any specific trailer. So this is specific to a particular template. Now, depending on templates, you can insert or remove these bubbles and have different aspects as well. But what we follow for now is to start off with the title of the entire trailer, then introducing authors, telling about the outlines, telling some stats about the learning pathway or course for which we are trying to create this trailer, then some social proof or validation, and finally ending with call to action. So this slide essentially talks about the theme generation flow to what all themes. So if you remember, we are having like title, author, outline. All these are six themes to what we play around. So now how are they stitched together is now we are going to see. So this middle element is the pathway that starts from R1 to R4, where R is nothing but a resource. Depending on the length of every resource, they might either go directly to a title generation model, which essentially generates a 5-10 word summarized, extreme summarized version for that resource. Or it might first go through a summarizer and then go through the title generation approach. And finally, what you get is T1 to T4, which is one title per resource, essentially. And obviously, now we are here playing around with unstructured resources. So it's not like we already have a structure wherein the titles are already available. So that's why the component of title generation comes into the play. And once you have, let's say, all the titles generated for all these resources that are mapped to the pathway, we have a stage of a resource selection and post-processing. Because again, since everything is derived by a template, so the outline section of a template might not be able to process all the resources, might not be able to put all the resources on the screen. So for example, if you have a pathway of 100 resources, then clearly 100 resources you cannot place it on the screen. And let's say the template allows for just placing 4 resources or 3 resources, what you can see in the figure, is the plan of how the resource selection or post-processing works, essentially. Then taking in the titles that you generate for all the resources along with the summaries is what is using which we kind of come up with the title for the entire trailer, which is marked with the one number over here. Covering these two themes, we move on to the statistics part, where we given elements like total reading time, then topic level, word cloud generation, then types of resources that you're going through based on the modalities they have and other details. And then author information and the validation is derived. We have two mechanisms. So author information is supposed to be given by the creator itself, where he gives in his name and image essentially. But we do have an automated element of extracting the affiliation images from the web and placing it as per the template theme. So as we move forward and when I show you the demo, it will be more clear. So now talking about the base of the entire project, where because this is what kind of powers multiple themes, which is title generation. So here, the idea, as the title says, is to generate a representative short crisp title for a given document. And hopefully, based on the distribution of the data that we have trained, it comes around to be 7-8 words. So on the left is what you see, the pipeline for our entire approach. This is the inference segment. All the yellow colored part, what you see, are independently tuned. So for example, let's say you given certain document based on the length. Now the length factor has come into the play because of the limitation of GPT-2 to not process very long documents, is because we have the summarizer module in place, which is a fine-tuned T5 model. So based on, finally, you get to the generation module either directly, if there's length is less than certain limit, or maybe through a summarizer module. Now generation module is again a fine-tuned GPT-2 based model, is what you can see on the right figure top, where you have the abstract, you have the keyword TLDR, and you kind of find it in a language modeling perspective with a loss of cross entropy that you backpropagate. And the words that you keep sampling at every time step till the end of the text token is reached is what you expect it to be the title. So we train this model on archive dataset of abstracts and titles, and tune and train that model over there is, and kind of use it for inference in this entire cycle. Once the model training is done, and when we use it for inference, for every document it gives me set of T number of titles. Now, which one is the best is the question out of those T titles. For that, we have derived a selection module, which is again a rule-based system. Now, based on our heuristics to what, while we were sampling our data set, we found like there are titles in the actual papers that are already present in the abstract as it is, which means just the string is as it is present is what authors have put them as the paper titles. So this is the first check that we do in our case also for any, let's say you give the abstract, we generate T titles. If any of the titles is present in the abstract as it is, we pick it up. Otherwise we go to another system, which is selectors. Selectors is what you see on the right bottom, which is a selection module. You give me abstract and set of titles, we do the first exact match. If yes, we are done. Otherwise, we go with the noun phrase overlap just to make sure the syntactic similarity is high. If that's above certain threshold, which again is tuned based on validation set. If that doesn't happen, then we go to the semantic similarity aspect. Instead of selecting anything random, it's better to select things that are close in the semantic and in the embedding space, for which we again use pre-trained transformers along with the cosine similarity to select this final title. Once you have the selected title, which is one title for that particular input document, can we do better was the question. So we train again, fine-tuned a GPT-2 model, but this time in a denoising fashion, which means the input was a noisy title and the output was the actual title. So we learned the weights as per this input and output pair under the same setting to how we fine-tuned our generation module. Now we have the final title. We have the refined title and we have the selected title. Now the question is, if your application allows for user intervention, then we have a scoring function which does a Jaccard similarity for both of these titles with the input abstract and gives the score and allows user to choose which one he wants to use based on the application, because an application might have a constrained limit of, let's say, 5 words, and as per that they can kind of choose which one to go for. If that's not the case and we are going with the automated system, which happens for this trailer flow, we sort them based on the scoring function of Jaccard similarity, and whichever has the highest is what we select. Now this is one of the examples for the entire flow. This was the abstract. This is the actual title of that paper. Now these are the 5 titles that we generate. And the red highlights that you see are nothing but the noun phrase overlaps. So title 1, title 2, and title 5 have one noun phrase overlap. But in the flow, if you remember, if it's not more than 2, then we go to the semantic similarity. So then we calculate semantic similarity of this with the underlying abstract. And title 1 had this similarity, had the highest similarity compared to 5 and 2. So that's what we highlight as green color, because that is the selected title. Now this goes to the refined module, and what you see as the refined title is in the most bottom of this figure. Then was the part of scoring function, which is represented as RS, which is relevance scoring. And the refined title got the highest score because it was able to correct person re-ID as person re-identification and remove the word deep, which didn't make sense considering the actual abstract. That way the improvement happened, and the final title, what you have in the automated setting, will be the refined title because of its higher relevancy score. So talking about the dataset and evaluation, the training that we do for the generation module is based on the left side table that you see. We train on the train split of 70% from the archive documents and test on the test part of the archive, as well as test on two different datasets, which is from ACL and ICMLA. And these are the number of documents and the statistics that they own. The right side is the evaluation with the classical methods, along with attention-based bidirectional GRU and zero-shot GPT-2 setting and R method. We evaluated on Rouge and Blue, which is again an overlap of n-grams in terms of recall and precision. So now comes the that aspect where I was talking about, let's say you're given 100 resources or 10 resources, but the template essentially allows you to position just 4 resources, for example, which is seen in this figure. So the image that you see is again a frame from a template, which clearly tells us, okay, 4 elements are only possible to be placed over here. So again, the idea is the elements on the screen should not be redundant, as in they should not be saying same thing. For the, let's say 2, 3, and 4 should not be representing the same thing. So the idea is, the goal essentially over here is to maximize diversity in this case, and select K resources from total of N resources where K is less than equal to N. So this is the flowchart that we devised for the same. So you're given N resources. The first task is to filter out any assessments, because that is not what we want to place in the outline. Those hold a good candidate in the statistics part. Then we filter any short documents because of low information they might contain. Then the third step, we filter the exact or the near duplicate. So any resources that are exact duplicates, we remove them. We remove any near duplicates. Now near duplicates is done based on threshold-based Jaccard similarity. So this is all syntactic filtering that's happening for the third step. Then the number of, let's say from N, we now come down to N by 2. We apply a title generation system, what we discussed previously, to each of these resources to get a sequence of titles essentially across all those resources. We freeze the first and the kth position because first and last elements are important, and they are sort of bound to, they are sort of bounding the topics to be learned in any particular course. Now the task is to fill the middle two elements, which is the K minus two elements are supposed to be filled. Then we again go about, because we have generated titles for each of them, we filter out exact titles because again, because of the nature of the probabilistic, what we have, the GPT-2 system. It might be possible like this trailer, the titles that we generate might be duplicate or maybe near duplicates is what we filter out in this step essentially. Then we go about also deduplicating semantic duplicates, because till now we have been playing around with syntactic duplicates where words might be switched here and there, but what if the words are totally different, but semantically they mean the same thing? So this is where we kind of remove those elements. And after that, we divide our space into equal spaced bins. So in for example, if we were to choose 10 documents, we have already chosen first and 10th. We are left with 8 elements in that N space. And let's say we are given of choice of 4 elements to be picked and put it in the K place. We divide that space by 4. And from each of them, each of those bins, we randomly pick one of the outline candidate and place it to have our full K length outline, which is 1, 02, 03, and K. So here we, for every, wherever you see filtering duplicates, each of them are threshold guided with a, or to be very particular, these are relaxed threshold to avoid any cases where we do a early stopping. So it is guaranteed in this pipeline, like we'll be going from first to last as we proceed with this entire flow. It will not be stopping somewhere in between. Now comes the other aspect, which is how do you generate title for the entire trailer? So this is the flowchart that we follow. Let's say the task is to generate title for the trailer. So the first thing that we look out for, because we give an option in the creator's dashboard, if user wants to enter some summary around the entire course, if that's there, we use that and pass it through a trailer title generator system and get the trailer title. If that's not there, we fall back to this blue colored thing. I'll talk about what this model is, but that is also supposed to give us set of titles. If we find a clear winner over there, again, I'll talk about what clear winner is. Then we select the title, else we fall back to the third and the last resort, which is we pick the first resource in that pathway and consider it to be the introductory resource and generate title for that, and which eventually becomes the title for the entire trailer. So this was the system that I was talking about. So this is a keyword style title generation system where we have a learning resource, 1 to 4. S is the summarizer for which we generate A1 to A4, which are set of all the abstracts, 1-to-1 mapping with the resources. We use each of these abstracts to generate title and we get T1 to T4. Now M1 to M4 are keyword extracting methods over different input sources. And we primarily play around with YAKE and TextRank. And once we have set of keyword from each of these systems, the next step is to find the relevance of each keyword in semantic space with the abstract set that we have created. Because again, with the keyword extractor, we have already filtered out important set of keywords, is the keyword important in the holistic aspect of the learning pathway is what we are trying to calculate over here. And then we do an intersection, whichever is most common across that as well, we choose that one. And that is the highest scoring keyword, which we put as a pathway title. Now here again, if the intersection, what I just said, which was clear winner means if the intersection, which means there's no skewness that we have seen in the intersection, like for example, that keyword one might be occurring 3 times as in the intersection part, but rest of them are occurring 1 time. So that's where the skewness comes in and we select it from there. But in case there was no intersection and everybody gets the score 1, then we fall back to the last one, which is pick first resource and go for the title generator from there. Now comes the part of video composition. So now we talk about video composition system, which is where all the stitching from all the elements essentially happen. So we have talked about how we are trying to generate themes for each of these frames across the entire template for a trailer. The next task was to generate the voiceover as well. So what we use is essentially a template based generator that takes in, that kind of translates all the elements that are supposed to be there in a frame in a natural language setting with the help of slot based grammar. So we have certain grammar with certain fill in the blanks is what we use to generate text for every frame that is supposed to be spoken. We use those inputs and pass it through a text-to-speech engine, and we are using Watson for that to get the voice version for the same thing. Now, depending on the speaker speaking rate, and this again is one of the things that we give to the creator while he's using the dashboard in terms of what feature, what kind of voice does he want. Based on the speaker rate, we select the duration of the frame, because it should not be like the frame is not changed yet the speaker is speaking for the next frame. So that setting is done. And eventually we use all of that to generate subtitles as well that will be placed in the video. Along with the splash screen sound. So we use 2 layers of sound, which is background and the voiceover, along with the template properties, as in the position of elements and the type of elements that are eligible for a frame in a particular template. Once all of that mixes up is what you see as MP4 file, and that we call as trailer. Apart from whatever I have discussed today, we do have helper functions as well, which are about definition extraction, sentence type detection, video generation. So video generation, for example, if I want to put an automated generated video in my trailer, then one of the basic ways what we are doing is to kind of first extract all the images from the input documents. So let's say if you give me a machine learning book, so I'll be first extracting all the images, then kind of remapping if an image is belonging to the outlines to what we have selected. stitch them, crop them, and do a marquee over there, and so that it looks like there's a video being generated. And at the back end, you can add a definition or a sentence that's declarative, so to say. And then we have image auto fit as well. If you give an image that is not inbound with the dimensions that is required to be in a trailer frame, we can do an auto crop. We can do face recognition. If, for example, if any of the templates require you to just show the face, but creator, let's say, gave an image of he from a distant far place. So we can do face recognition and place that image as well in that frame. Then image retriever again allows you to go through the web and crawl necessary informations if required. So now comes the task of how do you evaluate this entire system, because this looks like a sort of generative task where you have a notion of creativity also embedded in this. So clearly objective evaluation was not straightforward, because the effectiveness of a trailer or maybe of a summary is highly subjective and relies on human perception. And also there was lack of ground truth data set that we had. So to evaluate the entire overall trailer, we perform user survey, where we float 6 trailers across 3 different corpora. And 3 different corpora were a subset of chapters from machine learning textbook, a week sampled from academic course on NLP, and the third was the entire ML textbook. So these are the 3 trailers that we create. And each of them had 2 versions because of the templates that we design. And each of these templates differ at the level of aesthetics and level of detail. So, and then we designed a survey of 8 questions per trailer, targeting the aspects like informativeness, completeness, impact, aesthetics, and so on. So what you see over here are all those 8 questions. I have done an underline over the main intent of that question, just to summarize really quickly. Now, the right side is what you see. We have a total of 63 participants who evaluated all of these trailers. And Q1 to Q8 is nothing but the question, what you see on the left-hand side, and the y-axis is the scores that we get. So this is across all the courses and across all the templates. Once we normalize and take the average is what is shown over here. We do plot other plots as well, which is to evaluate a template as well. But here I'm just showing across all courses and across all trailers. So we do a Likert scale-based evaluation where 1 is very poor and 5 is very good. 3 is the okay segment, which is drawn in red color. And the 3.99 is the average, overall average to what we see when once you average Q1 to Q8. And in any, and the particular bar is an average across multiple trailers and multiple courses. So the score that we get is 3.99, which is close to good. So also apart from this, I discussed in the starting, like we have a notion of creator's dashboard, where the creator dashboard enables a creator to make trailer in a couple of clicks, and additionally giving creator the functionality to edit frames with the relevant information and accept other user preferences. So these are 2 screenshots. The left one, so this is under progress as of now. So these are 2 screenshots. On the left hand side, you can see, you can select a pathway, you can select resources that you want to be in a trailer. That's again optional. If you want, you can just select all of them. You can use the current system where this is going to be integrated, or if you have a dump from your system, then you can utilize those set of resources as well. The next thing is to select template. So this, clicking on this again plays a video that I showed in the starting. It tells you where your elements are going to be and how is it going to look like at the end of the day. Then author's image, author name is what you are supposed to give. And then we have all the radio buttons in terms of tuning in your preferences and your expectation in terms of what trailer do you want. Do you want subtitles or not? Do you want background sound or not? What kind of voiceover do you want? So these are some of them, because it was pretty horizontally scrollable, but we have almost 10, 11 aspects that you can play around with. And finally, once the trailer is done, is what you see the right screen, where you have the generated trailer. You can download it. You see all the frames that the model generated. You also see a pencil icon for every frame. If you click on that, it opens a dialog box where you can edit the information that's there inside the frame. You can rechange your options that you did for the previous. For example, if you hadn't selected subtitles for the first screen, but now you want it, so you can still change all of those settings. The right-hand side is the suggestions area, where we show all the definitions that we have extracted all the other titles, candidate titles that could have been the part of trailer. But again, this is the area that we give for user to kind of tune in and personalize as per his preferences. Because again, as I said, this is a little creative aspect. So depending on the creator, this will change. So now I'll just show a quick trailer that we created automatically. And the data set that we used was, again, the chapters sequentially sampled from machine learning textbook and particularly deep learning book.
Hello, I welcome you all to this course on feed forward neural networks. My name is Joshua Bengio, and I am currently a professor at University of Montreal. And I am the primary instructor for this course. In this specially curated course, we will learn about feed forward neural networks. A visual overview followed by regularization in deep learning, optimization techniques, neural network training, and then eventually finishing it off by understanding recurrent neural networks. As a part of the curriculum, you will go through approximately 5 text resources in total, containing over 8 hours of total read time. We also have an TA-mediated discussion forum to help you out during this course. Also, around 300 users with completion rate of 95%. So, what are you waiting for? Start your journey today. This is Joshua Bengio signing off.
So yeah, that was one of the trailers that we create for, again, the data set being chapters sampled sequentially from a machine learning textbook. So again, the aspects that you saw, which were where the text was written, was again automatically placed, although we had positions defined because the template, because essentially it's a template guided, so you know the coordinates where the text is supposed to be placed. And the word cloud and all what you see is automatically generated. So again, so wrapping it up, so the future work for this is to complete the creator's dashboard, try to add other interesting elements to the trailer and scaling it across multiple more templates with multiple other themes. Yeah, thank you so much. And these are all the publications with respect to both the talks that we are given today. We are open for any questions.
Thank you, Prakar. If there are any questions, we can take up.
Yeah, so both of these, right? So the part about finding this, finding the pathway for the navigator learning as well as the trailer, how much of it does it depend on the subject that you're handling? Because different subjects will have different kinds of tendencies to make collaterals, right? Say, for example, if it's maths, it's going to be different, and science is going to be different, right? So from your experience, what has been the case? I'm looking at this is for both Chaitali and Prakar.
Yes, actually, for this learning pathway, we have generated different model for different subject. Like all you have to do is go ahead and train it. We are still looking at generalizing it, where we can take a lot of learning pathways and try to see if we are able to generalize it.
Okay.
So right now it is mostly for based on subject, whereas the narrative arc generation, where I was generating MCQ and overviews, those are not specific for the subject.
Okay.
We want to get that to learning pathway as well.
Yeah, same with the case with the trailer aspect. So the models that we have are pretty, the architecture is generic. Again, since these are tuned for a particular subject or data set, so clearly the performance is going to be very much better over there. But even if there is, again, depends, since we are using pre-trained GPT-2 and fine-tuning it later, so clearly if the pre-training is already done on pretty large scale, so the generalization capability increases. But to be really specific, if you want to, let's say, generate on psychology course or something of that sort, then clearly some aspect of retraining would be required with certain number of documents in that space.
Okay. Thank you. I had a related question for Chaitali on the MCQs. So the MCQs are all single response MCQs, right? Or one can have multiple responses, or it doesn't matter?
Yeah, it is mostly the single response means it's mostly a factual question, and you're already giving the question answer there as a correct answer. and some other options.
Okay. So,
is that what you asked?
Yes. Yes. So, yeah. So, even for a factual question, you can have multiple responses, right? So, they can be because you are anyways finding semantic similarity to between the choices, right? So, have you come across where you have intended single response, but the question turned out to be multiple response?
We are, even while giving options, we are trying to see that the options are not close to the actual correct answer. So we are having a check that it should not be very close to it. But we have not faced such a question where it will have two answers.
Okay. Thank you so much. Thank you for the nice
one. Thank you, Jaya. And if there are no more questions, I think we can end this talk at this note. So thanks once again, both Chaitali and Prakhar for your talk. And I guess for Prakhar, I think it's almost a practice talk for his defense as well. So hoping that it will lead to there soon. And so all the best for completing this work. Thanks, everyone. Thanks once again for coming.